Agendath is a wasteland, a home of screech owls and the sand-blind Eupupa. Netaim the golden is no more. And on the highway of the clouds they come, muttering thunder of rebellion, the ghosts of beasts. Ha! Hark! Ha! Parallax stalks behind and goads them, the lancinating lightnings of whose brows are scorpions. Elk and yak, the bulls of Bashan and of Babylon, mammoth and mastodon, they come trooping to the sunken sea. Lacus mortis, ominous, revengeful, zodiacal host. They moan, passing upon the clouds, horned and capricorned, the trumpeted with the tusked, the lion-maned, the giant-antlered, snouter and crawler, rodent, ruminant and pachyderm, all their moving, moaning multitude, murderers of the sun. Onward to the Dead Sea they tramp to drink, unslaked and with horrible gulpings, the salt somnolent inexhaustible flood. And the equine portent grows again, magnified in the deserted heavens, nay, to heaven's own magnitude, till it looms vast over the house of Virgo. And lo, wonder of metempsychosis, it is she, the everlasting bride, harbinger of the day-star, the bride ever-virgin. It is she, Martha, thou lost one, Millicent, the young, the dear, the radiant. How serene does she now arise, a queen among the Pleiades, in the penultimate Antelucan hour, shod in sandals of bright gold, coiffed in a veil of, what you call it, gossamer. It floats, it flows about her starborn flesh, and loose it streams, emerald, sapphire, mauve, and heliotrope, sustained on currents of the cold interstellar wind, winding, coiling, simply swirling, writhing in the skies a mysterious writing, till, after a myriad metamorphoses of symbol, it blazes alpha, a ruby and triangled sign, upon the forehead of Taurus. Francis was reminding Stephen of years before, when they had been at school together in Conmee's time. He asked about Glaucon, Alcibiades, Pisistratus. Where were they now? Neither knew. "You have spoken of the past and its phantoms," Stephen said. "Why think of them? If I call them into life across the waters of Lethe, will not the poor ghosts troop to my call? Who supposes it? I, Bus Stephanoumenos, bullock-befriending bard, am lord and giver of their life." He encircled his gadding hair with a coronal of vine leaves, smiling at Vincent. "That answer and those leaves," Vincent said to him, "will adorn you more fitly when something more, and greatly more, than a capful of light odes can call your genius father. All who wish you well hope this for you. All desire to see you bring forth the work you meditate, to acclaim you Stephaneforus. I heartily wish you may not fail them." "Oh no," Vincent Lenehan said, laying a hand on the shoulder near him. "Have no fear. He could not leave his mother an orphan." The young man's face grew dark. All could see how hard it was for him to be reminded of his promise and of his recent loss. He would have withdrawn from the feast had not the noise of voices allayed the smart. Madden had lost 5 drachmas on Sceptre for a whim of the rider's name, Lenehan as much more. He told them of the race. "The flag fell and, off, scamper, the mare ran out freshly with O'Madden up. She was leading the field. All hearts were beaten. Even Phyllis could not contain herself. She waved her scarf and cried, 'Huzzah! Sceptre wins!' But in the straight on the run home, when all were in close order, the dark horse throwaway drew level, reached, outstripped her. All was lost now. Phyllis was silent. Her eyes were sad anemones. 'Juno,' she cried, 'I am undone.' But her lover consoled her and brought her a bright casket of gold in which lay some oval sugar plums which she partook. A tear fell, only one. 'A whacking fine whip,' said Lenehan, 'is W. Lane. 4 winners yesterday and 3 today. What rider is like him? Mount him on the camel or the boisterous buffalo and the victory in a hack canter is still his. But let us bear it as was the ancient wont. Mercy on the luckless. Ah, poor Sceptre!" he said with a light sigh. "She is not the filly that she was. Never by this hand shall we behold such another. By gad, sir, a queen of them. Do you remember her, Vincent? I wish you could have seen my queen today," Vincent said. "How young she was, and radiant. Lalage was scarce fair beside her. in her yellow shoes and frock of muslin, I do not know the right name of it. The chestnuts that shaded us were in bloom. The air drooped with their persuasive odour, and with pollen floating by us. In the sunny patches one might easily have cooked on a stone a batch of those buns, with Corinth fruit in them, that Periplebomenes sells in his booth near the bridge. But she had naught for her teeth but the arm with which I held her, and in that she nibbled mischievously when I pressed too close. A week ago she lay ill 4 days on the couch, but today she was free, blithe, mocked at peril. She is more taking then, her posy's tool-mad romp that she is. She had pulled her fill as we reclined together, and in your ear, my friend, you will not think who met us as we left the field. Conmee himself. He was walking by the hedge, reading. I think a breviary book with him. I doubt not a witty letter in it from Glycera or Chloe to keep the page. The sweet creature turned all colours in her confusion, feigning to reprove a slight disorder in her dress. A slip of underwood clung there, for the very trees adore her. When Conmee had passed, she glanced at her lovely echo in that little mirror she carries. But he had been kind. In going by, he had blessed us. "The gods, too, are ever kind," Lenehan said. "If I had poor luck with Bass's mare, perhaps this draught of his may serve me more propensely." He was laying his hand upon a wine-jar. Malachy saw it, and withheld his act, pointing to the stranger and to the scarlet label. "Warily," Malachy whispered, "preserve a druid silence. His soul is far away. It is as painful, perhaps, to be awakened from a vision as to be born. Any object, intensely regarded, may be a gate of access to the incorruptible aeon of the gods. Do you not think it, Stephen?"
"Theosophus told me so,"
Stephen answered, "whom in a previous existence Egyptian priests initiated into the mysteries of karmic law. The lords of the moon, Theosophus told me, an orange fiery shipload from planet Alpha of the lunar chain, would not assume the etheric doubles, and these were therefore incarnated by the ruby-coloured egos from the second constellation. However, as a matter of fact, though, the preposterous surmise about him being in some description of a doldrums or other, or mesmerised, which was entirely due to a misconception of the shallowest character, was not the case at all. The individual, whose visual organs, while the above was going on, were at this juncture commencing to exhibit symptoms of animation, was as astute, if not astuter, than any man living, and anybody that conjectured the contrary would have found themselves pretty speedily in the wrong shop. During the past 4 minutes or thereabouts, he had been staring hard at a certain amount of number one Bass, bottled by Messrs. Bass and Co. at Burton-on-Trent, which happened to be situated amongst a lot of others right opposite to where he was, and which was certainly calculated to attract anyone's remark on account of its scarlet appearance. He was simply and solely, as it subsequently transpired for reasons best known to himself, which put quite an altogether different complexion on the proceedings, after the moment before's observations about boyhood days and the turf, recollecting two or three private transactions of his own, which the other two were as mutually innocent of as the babe unborn. Eventually, however, both their eyes met, and as soon as it began to dawn on him that the other was endeavouring to help himself to the thing, he involuntarily determined to help himself, and so he accordingly took hold of the neck of the medium-sized glass recipient, which contained the fluid sought after, and made a capacious hole in it by pouring a lot of it out with, also at the same time, however, a considerable degree of attentiveness, in order not to upset any of the beer that was in it about the place. The debate which ensued was, in its scope and progress, an epitome of the course of life. Neither place nor counsel was lacking in dignity. The debaters were the keenest in the land, the theme they were engaged on the loftiest and most vital. The High Hall of Horne's House had never beheld an assembly so representative and so varied, nor had the old drafters of that establishment ever listened to a language so encyclopaedic. A gallant scene, in truth, it made. Crothers was there at the foot of the table in his striking Highland garb, his face glowing from the briny airs of the Mull of Galloway. There, too, opposite to him, was Lynch, whose countenance bore already the stigmata of early depravity and premature wisdom. Next the Scotsman was the place assigned to Costello, the eccentric, while at his side was seated in stolid repose the squat form of Madden. The chair of the resident indeed stood vacant before the hearth, but on either flank of it the figure of Bannon, in explorer's kit of tweed shorts and salted cowhide brogues, contrasted sharply with the primrose elegance and town-bred manners of Malachy Rowland St. John Mulligan. Lastly, at the head of the board, was the young poet who found a refuge from his labours of pedagogy and metaphysical inquisition in the convivial atmosphere of Socratic discussion, while to the right and left of him were accommodated the flippant prognosticator fresh from the hippodrome, and that vigilant wanderer, soiled by the dust of travel and combat, and stained by the mire of an indelible dishonour, but from whose steadfast and constant heart no lure or peril or threat or degradation could ever efface the image of that voluptuous loveliness which the inspired pencil of Lafayette has limned for ages yet to come. It had better be stated here and now at the outset that the perverted transcendentalism to which Mr. S. Dedalus's Div. Sep. contentions would appear to prove him pretty badly addicted runs directly counter to accepted scientific methods. Science, it cannot be too often repeated, deals with tangible phenomena. The man of science, like the man in the street, has to face hard-headed facts that cannot be blinked, and explain them as best he can. There may be, it is true, some questions which science cannot answer at present, such as the first problem submitted by Mr. L. Bloom, Pub. Canv., regarding the future determination of sex. Must we accept the view of Empedocles of Trinacria, that the right ovary, the post-menstrual period, assert others, is responsible for the birth of males, or are the too long neglected spermatozoa, or nemasperms, the differentiating factor, or is it, as most embryologists incline to opine, such as Culpepper, Spallanzani, Blumenbach, Lusk, Herzweg, Leopold and Valenti, a mixture of both? This would be tantamount to a cooperation, one of nature's favourite devices, between the nisus formativus of the nemasperm on the one hand, and on the other a happily chosen position, succubitus felix of the passive element. The other problem raised by the same inquirer is scarcely less vital, infant mortality. It is interesting because, as he pertinently remarks, we are all born in the same way, but we all die in different ways. Mr. M. Mulligan, Hyge et Huge Doc, blames the sanitary conditions in which our grey-lunged citizens contract adenoids, pulmonary complaints, etc., by inhaling the bacteria which lurk in dust. These factors, he alleged, and the revolting spectacles offered by our streets, hideous publicity posters, religious ministers of all denominations, mutilated soldiers and sailors, exposed scorbutic car drivers, the suspended carcasses of dead animals, paranoid bachelors and unfructified duennas, these, he said, were accountable for any and every falling off of the calibre of the race. Callipedia, he prophesied, would soon be generally adopted, and all the graces of life, genuinely good music, agreeable literature, light philosophy, instructive pictures, plaster-cast reproductions of the classical statues such as Venus and Apollo, artistic coloured photographs of prize babies, all these little attentions would enable ladies who were in a particular condition to pass the intervening months in a most enjoyable manner. Mr. J. Crothers, Disc Back, attributes some of these demises to abdominal trauma in the case of women workers subjected to heavy labours in the workshop, and to the marital discipline in the home, but by far the vast majority to neglect, private or official, culminating in the exposure of newborn infants, the practice of criminal abortion, or in the atrocious crime of infanticide. Although the former, we are thinking of neglect, is undoubtedly only too true, the case he cites of nurses forgetting to count the sponges in the peritoneal cavity is too rare to be normative. In fact, when one comes to look into it, the wonder is that so many pregnancies and deliveries go off so well as they do, all things considered, and in spite of our human shortcomings, which often balk nature in her intentions. An ingenious suggestion is that thrown out by Mr. V. Lynch, Back a Rith, that both natality and mortality, as well as all other phenomena of evolution, tidal movements, lunar phases, blood temperatures, diseases in general, everything, in fine, in nature's vast workshop, from the extinction of some remote sun to the blossoming of one of the countless flowers which beautify our public parks, is subject to a law of numeration as yet unascertained. Still, the plain, straightforward question, why a child of normally healthy parents and seemingly a healthy child, and properly looked after, succumbs unaccountably in early childhood, though other children of the same marriage do not, must certainly, in the poet's words, give us pause. Nature, we may rest assured, has her own good and cogent reasons for whatever she does, and in all probability such deaths are due to some law of anticipation by which organisms in which morbus germs have taken up their residence, modern science has conclusively shown that only the plasmic substance can be said to be immortal, tend to disappear at an increasingly earlier stage of development, an arrangement which, though productive of pain to some of our feelings, notably the maternal, is nevertheless, some of us think, in the long run, beneficial to the race in general, in securing thereby the survival of the fittest. Mr. S. Dedalus's Div. Sep. remark, or should it be called an interruption, that an omnivorous being which can masticate, deglute, digest, and apparently pass through the ordinary channel with pluterperfect imperturbability such multifarious aliments as cancrenous females emaciated by paturation, corpulent professional gentlemen, not to speak of jaundiced politicians and chlorotic nuns, might possibly find gastric relief in an innocent collation of staggering bob, reveals as naught else could, and in a very unsavoury light, the tendency above alluded to. For the enlightenment of those who are not so intimately acquainted with the minutiae of the municipal abattoir as this morbid-minded aesthete and embryo philosopher, who, for all his overweening bumptiousness in things scientific, can scarcely distinguish an acid from an alkali, prides himself on being, it should perhaps be stated that staggering bob, in the vile parlance of our lower-class licensed victuallers, signifies the cookable and eatable flesh of a calf newly dropped by its mother. In a recent public controversy with Mr. L. Bloom, Pub. Canv., which took place in the Commons Hall of the National Maternity Hospital, 29, 30 and 31 Hollis Street, of which, as is well known, Dr. A. Horn, Lice in Midway, FKQCPI, is the able and popular master, he is reported by eyewitnesses as having stated that once a woman has let the cat into the bag, an aesthete's allusion presumably to one of the most complicated and marvellous of all nature's processes, the act of sexual congress, she must let it out again or give it life, as he phrased it, to save her own. At the risk of her own, was the telling rejoinder of his interlocutor, none the less effective for the moderate and measured tone in which it was delivered. Meanwhile, the skill and patience of the physician had brought about a happy accouchement. It had been a weary, weary while for both patient and doctor. All that surgical skill could do was done, and the brave woman had manfully helped. She had. She had fought the good fight, and now she was very, very happy. Those who have passed on, who have gone before, are happy too as they gaze down and smile upon the touching scene. Reverently look at her as she reclines there with the mother light in her eyes, that longing hunger for baby fingers, a pretty sight it is to see, in the first bloom of her new motherhood, breathing a silent prayer of thanksgiving to one above, the universal husband. And as her loving eyes behold her babe, she wishes only one blessing more, to have her dear Dodie there with her to share her joy, to lay in his arms that mite of God's clay, the fruit of their lawful embraces. He is older now, you and I may whisper it, and a trifle stooped in the shoulders, yet in the whirligig of years a grave dignity has come to the conscientious second accountant of the Ulster Bank, College Green Branch. O Dodie,
loved one of old, faithful life-mate now, it may never be again, that far-off time of the roses. With the old shake of her pretty head, she recalls those days. God, how beautiful now across the mist of years! But their children are grouped in her imagination about the bedside, hers and his. Charlie, Mary Alice, Frederick Albert, if he had lived. Mamie, Budgie, Victoria Frances. Tom, Violet Constance Louisa. Darling little Bobsy, called after our famous hero of the South African War, Lord Bobs of Waterford and Kandahar. And now this last pledge of their union, a Purefoy, if ever there was one, with a true Purefoy nose. Young Hopeful will be christened Mortimer Edward, after the influential third cousin of Mr. Purefoy, in the Treasury Remembrancer's Office, Dublin Castle. And so time wags on, but Father Crinion has dealt lightly here. No, let no sigh break from that bosom, dear little Mina. And Dodie, knock the ashes from your pipe, the seasoned briar you still fancy when the curfew rings for you, may it be the distant day, and doubt the light whereby you read in the sacred book, for the oil too has run low. And so, with a tranquil heart, to bed, to rest. He knows and will call in his own good time. You too have fought the good fight and played loyally your man's part. Sir, to you my hand. Well done, thou good and faithful servant. There are sins, or let us call them as the world calls them, evil memories which are hidden away by man in the darkest places of the heart, but they abide there and wait. He may suffer their memory to grow dim, let them be as though they had not been, and all but persuade himself that they were not, or at least were otherwise. Yet a chance word will call them forth suddenly, and they will rise up to confront him in the most various circumstances, a vision or a dream, or while timbrel and harp soothe his senses, or amid the cool silver tranquillity of the evening, or at the feast at midnight, when he is now filled with wine. Not to insult over him will the vision come, as over one that lies under her wrath, not for vengeance to cut him off from the living, but shrouded in the piteous vesture of the past, silent, remote, reproachful. The stranger still regarded on the face before him a slow recession of that false calm there, imposed, as it seemed, by habit or some studied trick, upon words so embittered as to accuse in their speaker an unhealthiness, a flair for the cruder things of life. A scene disengages itself in the observer's memory, evoked, it would seem, by a word of so natural a homeliness as if those days were really present there, as some thought, with their immediate pleasures. A shaven space of lawn one soft May evening, the well-remembered grove of lilacs at Roundtown, purple and white, fragrant slender spectators of the game, but with much real interest in the pellets as they run slowly forward over the sward, or collide and stop, one by its fellow, with a brief alert shock. And yonder, about that grey urn, where the water moves at times in thoughtful irrigation, you saw another as fragrant sisterhood, Flowey, Attie, Tiny, and their darker friend, with I know not what of arresting in her pose then, Our Lady of the Cherries, a comely brace of them pendant from an ear, bringing out the foreign warmth of the skin so daintily against the cool ardent fruit. A lad of 4 or 5 in linsey woolsey, blossom time, but there will be cheer in the kindly hearth when ere long the bowls are gathered and touched, is standing on the urn secured by that circle of girlish fond hands. He frowns a little, just as this young man does now, with a perhaps too conscious enjoyment of the danger, but must needs glance at whiles towards where his mother watches from the piazzetta giving upon the flower close, with a faint shadow of remoteness or of reproach, alle verganglich, in her glad look. Mark this, father, and remember. The end comes suddenly. Enter that antechamber of birth where the studious are assembled, and note their faces. Nothing, as it seems, there of rash or violent. Quietude of custody, rather, befitting their station in that house. the vigilant watch of shepherds and of angels, about a crib in Bethlehem of Judah long ago. But, as before the lightning, the serried storm clouds, heavy with preponderant excess of moisture, in swollen masses turgidly distended, compassed the earth and sky in one vast slumber, impending above parched field and drowsy oxen, and blighted growth of shrub and verdure, till, in an instant, a flash rives their centres, and with the reverberation of the thunder, the cloudburst pours its torrent. So, and not otherwise, was the transformation, violent and instantaneous, upon the utterance of the word. "Burks!" outflings my Lord Stephen, giving the cry, and a tag and bobtail of all them after, Cockerel, Jackanapes, Welcher, Pill-Doctor, Punctual Bloom, at heels with a universal grabbing at headgear, ashplants, bilboss, Panama hats and scabbards, Zermatt alpenstocks and what not. A dedale of lusty youth, noble every student there. Nurse Callan, taken aback in the hallway, cannot stay them, nor smiling surgeon coming downstairs with news of placentation ended, a full pound of a milligram. They hark him on. The door, it is open. Ha! They are out, tumultuously, off for a minute's race, all bravely legging it, Burks of Denzel and Hollis, their ulterior goal. Dixon follows, giving them sharp language, but raps out an oath, he too and on. Bloom stays with nurse, a thought to send a kind word to happy mother and nursling up there. Dr. Diet and Dr. Quiet. Looks she too not other now? Ward of watching at Horn's house has told its tale in that washed-out pallor. Then all being gone, a glance of mother wit helping, he whispers close in going, Madam, when comes the stork bird for thee? The air without is impregnated with rain-dew moisture, life-essence celestial, glistening on Dublin stone under star-shiny Chalum. God's air, the All-Father's air, scintillant, circumambient, sessile air. Breathe it deep into thee. By heaven, Theodore Purefoy, thou hast done a doughty deed and no botch. Thou art, I vow, the remarkablest progenitor barring none in this chaffering, all-including, most farraginous chronicle. Astounding! In her lay, a God-framed, God-given, performed possibility which thou hast fructified with thy modicum of man's work. Cleave to her. Serve, toil on, labour like a very band-dog, and let scholarment and all Malthusiasts go hang. Thou art all their daddies, Theodore. Art drooping under thy load, bemoiled with butcher's bills at home and ingots, not thine, in the counting-house. Head up, for every new-begotten thou shalt gather thy homer of ripe wheat. See, thy fleece is drenched. Dost envy Darby Dullman there with his Joan? A canting jay and a rheum-eyed cur-dog is all their progeny. Pshaw! I tell thee, he is a mule, a dead gastropod without vim or stamina, not worth a cracked kreutzer. Copulation without population, no, I say. Herod's slaughter of the innocents were the truer name. Vegetables, forsooth, and sterile cohabitation. Give her beefsteaks, red, raw, bleeding. She is a hoary pandemonium of ills, enlarged glands, mumps, quinsy, bunions, hay fever, bed sores, ringworm, floating kidney, Derbyshire neck, warts, bilious attacks, gallstones, cold feet, varicose veins. A truce to Thranes and Trentals and Jeremies and all such congenital defunctive music. 20 years of it, regret them not. With thee it was not as with many that will and would and wait and never do. Thou sawest thy America, thy life-task, and didst charge to cover like the transpontine bison. How saith Zarathustra? Dina cu trupsal melkes du, nun trinkest du di susa milch des oiters. See, it displodes for thee in abundance. Drink, man, an udderful. Mother's milk, Purefoy, the milk of human kin. Milk, too, of those burgeoning stars overhead, rutilant in thin rain vapour, punch milk, such as those rioters will quaff in their guzzling den, milk of madness, the honey milk of Canaan's land. Thy cow's dug was tough, what? Aye, but her milk is hot and sweet and fattening, no dollop this, but thick, rich, bonny clabber. To her, old patriarch, pap, per diem partulam et pertundam nunc est bidendum.
All off for a buster, Armstrong, hollering down the street.
Bona fides, where you slept last night?
Timothy of the Battered Naggin.
Like old Billy-o.
Any brollies or gumboots in the family?
Where are the Henry Neville Sawbones and old Clo?
Sorrow one of me knows.
Hurrah there, Dix.
Forward to the ribbon counter.
Where's Punch?
All serene.
Jay, look at the drunken minister coming out of the maternity hospital.
Benedicat vus omnipotens deus, pater et filius.
A make, mister.
The Denzel Lane boys.
Hell blast ye.
Scoot. Righto, Isaacs, shove him out of the bleeding limelight.
You's join us, dear sir.
No intrusion in life.
Lou heap good man.
All he say me this bunch.
En avant, mes enfants. Fire away, number one on the gun. Burks, Burks.
Thence they advanced five parasangs. Slattery's mounted foot.
Where's that bleeding offer?
Parson Steve apostates creed.
No, no, Mulligan.
Abaft there, shove ahead. Keep a watch on the clock.
Chucking out time.
Mully, what's on you?
Ma mare, ma marie. British Beatitudes.
Let em plat em diggity boom boom.
Eyes have it.
To be printed and bound in the Druid drum press by two designing females. Calf covers of pissed on green. Last word in art shades. Most beautiful book come out of Ireland my time.
Silentium, get a sport on, Tentian.
Proceed to nearest canteen and their annex liquor stores. March, tramp, 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 the boys are attitudes parching. Beer, beef, business, bibles, bulldogs, battleships, boogery and bishops.
Whether on the scaffold high.
Beer, beef, trample the bibles.
When for Ireland dear.
Trample the tramplers, thunderation, keep the darned military step.
We fall.
Bishop's booze box.
Halt, heave to.
Rugger, scrum in.
No touch kicking. Ow me, tootsies.
You hurt?
Most amazingly sorry.
Query. Who's a standing this here do?
Proud possessor of damn all.
Declare misery.
Bet to the ropes.
Mean auntie salty. Not a red at me this week gone.
Yours.
Mead of our fathers for the Uber mensch.
Ditto.
Five number ones.
You, sir.
Ginger cordial.
Chase me the cabby's caudal. Stimulate the choleric.
Winding of his ticker. Stopped short, never to go again when the old.
Absent for me, savvy.
Caramba.
Have an eggnog or a prairie oyster.
Enemy.
Avuncular's got me timepiece.
Tenta.
Obliged awful.
Don't mention it. Got a pectoral trauma, eh, Dix?
Pause fact.
Got bit by a bumblebee whenever he was setting sleeping in his bit garden. Digs up near the matter.
Buckled he is.
Know his donor?
Yup, certainly do.
Full of a doer. See her in her dish, Billy. Peels off a credit.
Lovely lovekin.
None of your lean kind, not much.
Pull down the blind, love.
Two Ardlons.
Same here. Look slippery. If you fall, don't wait to get up.
5, 7, 9. Fine.
Got a prime pair of mince pies, no kid. And her takes me to rests and her anchor a rum. Must be seen to be believed.
Your starving eyes and all be plastered neck, you stole my heart, O glue pot.
Sir,
spud again the room it is.
All poppycock, you'll excuse me saying, for the high polloi.
I veer thee beast a Gert Vool.
Well, Doc, back fro Lapland.
Your corporosity sagaciating okay?
How's the squalls and papooses?
Woman body after going on the straw, stand and deliver.
Password. There's hair.
Ours the white death and the ruddy birth.
Hi, spit in your own eye, boss.
Mummer's wire, cribbed out of Meredith.
Jessified, orchidized, polysemical Jesuit.
Antimines writing Pa Kinch,
baddy bad Stephen, lead astray, goody good Malachy.
Haroo!
Collar the leather, young'un.
Round with a nappy. Here, jock bra, Highlandman's, your barley brie.
Lang me your lum reek and your kale pot boil.
My tipple.
Merci, here's to us.
How's that? Leg before wicket.
Don't stain me brand new synonyms.
Give us a shake of pep, you there.
Catch a holt.
Caraway say to carry away.
Twig.
Shrieks a silence.
every cove to his gentry mort. Venus Pandemos.
Le petite femme.
Bold bad girl from the town of Mullingar. Tell her I was axing at her. Harden Sarah by the weem. On the road to Malahide. Me.
If she who seduced me had left but the name. What do you want for ninepence? McCree McCrushkin, Smutty Moll for a mattress jig, and a pull altogether. X.
Waiting, governor?
Most deciduously.
Bet your boots on.
Stun-like. Seeing how no shine as is a-coming.
Under Constumble? He's got the chink ad lib. Seed near 3 pound on him a spell ago. I said we're hissing.
Us come right in on your invite, see? Up to you, matey.
Out with the youth. 2 bar and a wing.
You learn that go off they there Frenchy books.
Won't wash here for nuts nohow. Little chilly velly solly. Is the cutest colour coon down our side.
God's truth, Charlie.
We're nae fool. We're nae that fool.
Au reservoir, monsieur. Thanks you. 'Tis sure. What say?
In the speakeasy. Tight. I see you, sure. Bantam 2 days TT.
Bowsing nout but claret wine.
Garn, have a glint, do. Gum, I'm jiggered. And been to Barbary, have.
Too full for words.
With a railway bloke. How come you so? Opera he'd like. Rose of Castile.
Rose of Cast.
Police! Some H2O for a gent fainted.
Look at Bantam's flowers. Gemini. He's going to holler. The Colleen Bawn, my Colleen Bawn. Ah, cheese, it shut his blurry Dutch oven with a firm hand.
Had the winner today till I tipped him a dead cert. The Ruffin Cloy, the nab of Stephen Hand, has give me the J.D. Coppelin. He strike a telegram boy Paddock were a big bug base to the depot.
Shove him a Joey and Graham eyes.
Mare on form, hot order. Guinea to a goose gog.
Telegram that.
Gospel true. Criminal diversion.
I think that, yes.
Sure thing. Land him in Chokey Chokey if the Harman Beck cop the game. Madden back maddens a maddening back.
O lust, our refuge and our strength.
Decamping. Must you go?
Off to Mammy. Stand by. Hide me, blushes someone. All in if he spots me.
Come a home, our bantam.
Hurry var, mong view.
Dinna forget the cow slips for hersel.
Corn feed.
What gave ye thon colt? Pal to pal. Janock of John Thomas, her spouse.
No fake old man Leo.
S'help me, honest Injun.
Shiver me timbers if I had.
There's a great big holy friar.
Why for you no tell?
Well, I says, if that ain't a sheeny natches, well, I will get Misha Bishina. Through ye, the Lord, amen.
You have a motion. Steve, boy, you're going at some. More bluggy drunkables. Will immensely splendiferous standard permit one stutter of most extreme poverty and one large-sized grandacious thirst to terminate one expensive inaugurated libation?
Give us a breather.
Landlord, landlord, have you good wines to boo?
Hootsman, a wee drap de pree.
Curtain come again. Right, Boniface.
Absent the lot. No somnes beberimus viridum toxicum diabolus capitat posterioria nostria.
Closing time, gents. Eh? Rome booze for the bloom toff.
I hear you say onions. Blue.
Cadges ads.
Photos papli. By all that's gorgeous.
Play low, partner. Slide.
Bonsoir la compagnie and snares of the pox fiend. Where's the book of Namby Amby? Skunked. Leg bail. A wheel ye maun and gang your gates.
Checkmate. King to tower.
Kind Christian, will ye help young man whose friend took bungalow key to find place where to lay crown of his head tonight?
Crikey, I'm about sprung.
Eternally doggone my shins if this bein't the bestest, prettiest long break yet.
Item, curate, a couple of cookies for this child.
Cod's blood and brandy bells, none. Not a pint of cheeses.
Thrust syphilis down to hell, and with him those other licensed spirits.
Time, gents.
Who wander through the world.
Health all, à la votre.
Golly, what in tunk at yon guy in the Macintosh?
dusty roads, peep at his wearables.
By mighty, what's he got?
Jubilee mutton. Bovril by James.
Wants it real bad.
Do you ken bare socks?
See the cuss in the Richmond.
Raw there. Thought he had a deposit of lead in his penis.
Trumpery insanity.
Bartle the bread we calls him. That sort was once a prosperous sit. Man all tattered and torn that married a maiden all forlorn. Slung her hook she did. Here, see lost love. Walking Macintosh of Lonely Canyon. Tuck and turn in. Schedule time. Nix for the hornies. Pardon? Seen him today at a runiful. Chum of yourn passed in his checks. Lud a massy, poor pickaninnies.
Thou'll no be telling me that, Paul Veg.
Didum's bubble big splash cried tears cause friend Pudney was took off in black bag. Of all the darkies, Massa Pat was very best. I never see the like since I was born. Tion, tion. But 'tis well said that, my faith, yes.
Oh, get Rev on the gradient 1 and 9.
Live axle drives are souped. Lay a 2 to 1, Janazzi licks him Ruddywell Hollow. Jappies, high angle fire are in ya. Sunk by war special.
Be worse for him, says he, nor any Russian.
Tie them all.
There's 11 of them.
Get ye gone. Forward, woozy wobblers. Night.
Night.
May Allah, the excellent one, your soul this night ever tremendously conserve.
Your attention. Were nay that foo?
The Leith police dismitted us.
The Leith police.
Where hawks for the chap puking? Unwell in his abdominal regions.
Night.
Mona, my true love.
Mona, my own love.
Hark, shut your obstropolis.
Flap, flap, blaze on. There she goes. Brigade, bout ship, mount streetway. Cut up.
Flap.
Tally-ho. You not come. Run, skelter, race, flap.
Lynch.
Hey.
Sing along o' me.
Denzel Lane this way. Change here for Bawdy House. We too, she said, will seek the kips where Shady Mary is.
Righto, any old time.
Light a bunter in Cubilibus Seus.
You coming along?
Whisper.
Who the sooty hell's the Johnny in the Black Duds?
Hush. Sinned against the light, and even now that day is at hand when he shall come to judge the world by fire.
Flap.
Out implorent your scripture eye.
Strike up a ballad.
Then out spake Medical Dick to his comrade Medical Davy.
Christicle, who's this excrement yellow gospeler on the Marion Hall?
Elijah is coming, washed in the blood of the Lamb.
Come on, you wine-fizzling, gin-sizzling, booze-guzzling existences.
Come on, you doggone, bull-necked, beetle-browed, hog-jowled, peanut-brained, weasel-eyed, four-flushers, false alarms and excess baggage. Come on, you triple extract of infamy.
Alexander J. Christ Dowie, that's my name. That yanked to glory most half this planet from Frisco Beach to Vladivostok. The deity ain't no nickel-dime bum show. I put it to you that he's on the square, and a corking fine business proposition. He's the grandest thing yet, and don't you forget it. Shout salvation in King Jesus. You'll need to rise precious early, you sinner there, if you want to diddle the Almighty God.
Flop.
Not half. He's got a cough mixture with a punch in it for you, my friend, in his back pocket. Just you try it on.